This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
This week, Memphis City voters go to the polls. We'll have the latest on the mayor and city council races. Plus, former Mayor Willie Harrington submits his application to run his own charter schools. These were the stories reported this week by our roundtable of journalists, Bill Dries of the Memphis Daily News, Les Smith, Fox 13 News, Amos Mackey of the Commercial Appeal, Jackson Baker of the Memphis Flyer, and hosted by Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News. Welcome to Behind the Headlines. I'm Pierre Kimsey, sitting in for Eric Barnes. Well, our first topic is elections, and everybody at this table was out and about on Thursday night on this story. Let's start with Bill Dries, who's going to give us a little bit of an overview of who won and who lost in last night's election.
It was the night of the incumbents. This is the largest return of incumbents to the Memphis City Council in the 43-year history of the mayor-council form of government. Let's start at the top of the ballot with the mayor's race. A.C. Wharton, the incumbent, winning a full four-year term very easily with 65% of the vote. Now, by way of perspective, since we're talking about records, the record for a mayor for a mayoral candidate and since we've had the mayor council form of government is 74%, which Willie Harrington did in his 1995 reelection bid. Very respectable showing. Mm-hmm. District 1 on the city council, a district whose boundaries changed. You had Bill Morrison easily winning reelection there. In District 2, Bill Boyd, the incumbent, easily winning reelection there. The incumbent in District 3, Harold Collins, ran unopposed. So we go to District 4, Wanda Halbert, the incumbent, having no trouble with the field of three other challengers. District 5 was Jim Strickland, who was unopposed. So to District 6, where Edmund Ford Jr. was running basically a tandem campaign with his father, who was Wharton's top challenger in the mayor's race. Edmund Ford Jr. reelected to a second term on the city council. District 7, this is the race, the one race on the ballot without an incumbent. This was Barbara Swearingen Ware's council seat. Interim Councilmember Berlin Boyd now has that seat. This was a four-vote margin here with Lee Harris, the winner or the top finisher in this race over Kemba Ford. Because no one in this race got a majority of the votes, it goes to a November 10th runoff between Kemba Ford and Lee Harris. Mm-hmm. Let's move to the Super District contest. Super District 8, position 1, Joe Brown, who always runs up a big vote total, did so with 77% of the vote in that particular contest. Super District 8, position 2. This was the other race that was closely watched on election night. Janice Fullilove easily beating her main challenger, Rosalind Nichols. There were two other challengers in the race who finished way out of the money here. This was a race in which Wharton actually backed the challenger, Rosalind Nichols, on his ballot of endorsements that he put out. Mm-hmm. Super District 8, position 3 is Myron Lowry, the chairman, who had no opposition, and the highest vote total of the night, by the way. Super District 9, position 1, another very closely watched contest here between the incumbent Kemp Conrad and Paul Schaefer, a rerun of their 2008 contest for this council seat. But in this case, the municipal labor unions, which Schaefer is the head of one of those unions, put a lot of money and a lot of effort into this race, and Conrad battled back, hard-fought contest. Conrad is the winner. Super District 9, position 2. Shay Flynn had some opposition here from Jim Storia, a race that really had nothing to do with endorsements by the mayor or the union discontent with Wharton. Mm-hmm. Flynn racked up the highest percentage of the night with 80% of the vote there. And the final race, city court clerk, Thomas Long easily winning another four-year term, which will bring him to the 20-year mark in terms of holding office over two challengers.
Well, let's go back up to the top and talk about Mayor Wharton. Interesting part of the night for me was sitting there in the comfort of my living room while you guys were working and watching the mayor's acceptance speech. And it was, we've got some sound on that, and I want us to take a look at that real quick.
It just seems that people just want to keep on insulting the citizens of our great city and saying that in spite of obvious progress, in spite of obvious progress, that we're just going to throw anything out there and think you're going to be suckers enough to go and get off the path of progress. There has been an election tonight. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Play Johnny Taylor or something. Play something to get me back to who I am. I got that out. There's been an election. There's been an election.
Okay, Les, what is going on here?
Strange and erratic. We've always looked at AC as the congenial toastmaster, kind of like in the Georgie Jessel vein, and he'll always start off with a joke and all this. But he started off so dark here, and this was a personal thing with him. This was a cryptic response to some signs that he saw, some what he thought were personal attacks leveled against him. I think they're so low I didn't want to really get into it.
Well, of course, yeah.
But Amos, he knows a lot more about that motivation.
I think it's also a reflection of the mayor saying, what more can I do? I've brought thousands of jobs here. I inherited a dysfunctional and in some cases corrupt city government. I'm working to fix that. And the mayor believed that his main challengers were not fit for office and flat out said so. He said, Myron Lowry would be a good mayor. I can't say the same thing about my opponents. I think he felt that, I think he was personally offended that people had the temerity to challenge him, and listening to his remarks there, and challenge him on issues such as not giving incentives to businesses to come here, fantasy proposals about enacting a payroll tax to get employees their 4.6% payback. I think he, from listening to his remarks last night, he was kind of offended that people didn't recognize the job he had done over the last 2 years.
When he talked about these insults to this great city, that was a euphemism. He wasn't worried about insults to this great city, nor to some of the programs you're talking about. He was worried about those insults that Les was talking about him personally. And I can almost imagine Willie Harrington, the famous, often irascible Willie Harrington, sitting at home watching, thinking, he's out of control.
Yeah, well, because Willie Harrington will tell you right off the bat that he was always a lightning rod. He knew that that's what came with the job.
He was thick-skinned.
AC's thin, apparently, is very thin. That's the real discovery here.
But Bill, look, this is the nature of the mayor's office. This is why the office of mayor of Memphis is different than the office of Shelby County mayor, is different than the office of just about anywhere else. It's the nature of the strong mayor form of government. This is what happens to people who hold the office. You have so much to do, and you have so much more power than the Shelby County mayor does as a function of the way the government is laid out, that there really isn't a lot of time or use for the niceties of political formality.
You can't be all things to all people. That's it. When you're the mayor of Memphis, you can't be all things to all people. And people like him on a personal level. There's no doubt to that. I mean, he's won four times now with a huge margins. He's the most prolific vote getter probably in the history of Shelby County. But the fact is that there are people out there that don't like his policies, they don't like the decisions he's made, and they voice their opposition against it through their ballot.
And the one thing I noticed about this election, by the way, to shift tracks a little bit, is that the number 65% keeps cropping into all these results. I would say 65% of these candidates won by 65%. It's amazing, which indicates that a lot of this stuff just played out automatically.
It's like Ed Ford, he got all his votes in early voting. That was probably the energized union support, you know, the unions that supported him. And his early voting total, I think it was around over 30%. And it never went up after that. It only dropped down to 28%.
It applies to everybody except that race in District 7, which really was a race, which was dead even. You couldn't get much more dead even.
Well, here's my question about Ed Ford. You know, I mean, Ed Ford is a politically astute guy. And, I mean, he looked at what was going on. He had to know that he couldn't win against Mayor Wharton. But at the same time, I was wondering if he was basically, at this point in his career, testing his political viability in some way.
No,
You don't think so?
No, I think he was. I think he was talked into running for this, first of all, because of the Ford family name, and some of the union leaders mistakenly believe that the Ford name automatically translates into this kind of political power. So they put some money behind him to see what would happen. And the Ford name still carries power, but it carries power when members of that family work very hard at what they do. I just don't think he had it this time around.
We're going to find out on November 10th just how much power remains in the name Ford. I think Kemba Ford, I consider her the favorite in that runoff election.
Well, and I was talking to a Wharton source last night, and they say they're going to go full out for Lee Harris starting on Monday against Kemba Ford, that it will be the Fords against Wharton. That's not probably a battleground that I don't think the Wharton administration is going to be successful
in. Yeah, and that brings up another question. That there were certain picks that Mayor Wharton had in for the council, and I'm not exactly up to speed to the background of Mayor Wharton's relationship with Janice Fully Love, but we've got some sound here, and I want you to hear what Janice Fully Love said last night.
Mayor Wharton, I'm going to be a thorn in your side for everything that I think is against the people right here in the city of Memphis. And I tell you, my voice, you think it has been loud, baby, it's going to be even louder. Trust that.
It brings up the whole question, should Mayor Wharton even be picking council seats?
Well, because you end up in a situation like this. Janice has opposed the mayor on most of his major issues.
Yeah, you told me about the phone call where she called your house.
We were going to the Children's Museum. I got a phone call, and the first things I heard was, who does he think he is, Boss Crump? And so you get in the situation where the mayor steps out and endorses a challenger, and the incumbent blows out the challenger. And so now the incumbent is upset, and you just heard her, I'm going to be a thorn in your side. And she would have voted against pension reform and pay cuts and all of that stuff anyway. Okay.
Yeah, well, that was
but now she's extra fired up.
And that was probably the flat calculation that AC Wharton
correct.
Made.
Here's the thing. When you look at AC's endorsements, didn't seem to inflect this election one bit. Maybe a couple of points off Janice Fully Love's total, maybe. You look at the union endorsements, they also had no power whatsoever. I think, again, that 65%, that's mainly an incumbent factor. It's a name recognition factor. That's what happened in this election.
But I think the loser of the night, though, was the unions.
No doubt.
They didn't get their guy, Paul Schaefer, through there. Yeah, Janice got through. But, the fact is that their whole campaign, Bill's talked about this before, it was fragmented. They were going to concentrate first going after Kemp Conrad. But then it got fragmented into going after A.C. Wharton, but not actually speaking his name directly in the commercials. It was very, very strange and not focused.
Using resources to go after Mayor Wharton was a fatal strategic error for them. If they had focused on Conrad, you take away a vote that's supporting the mayor's reforms of city government, you accomplish the same thing. I mean, there was no way Mayor Wharton was going to lose this election. But so it was a waste of time and resources to focus on him when they could have focused on Conrad Schaefer.
But I think what they were after was to dampen the party. I mean, Wharton was running for a number. He wasn't really running for a victory. He was running for a number, and I think the union's goal was legitimate in that they wanted to cut down that number because the number meant more to him than beating Ed Ford or James Harvey. Mm-hmm. And so what happened was they had to pick between one of the two priorities, and they didn't.
And on this thing that Les mentioned, the fact that the mayor's people are aiming all their arsenal now at this November 10th runoff in District 7, well, he's already shown the lack of power of his ballot. He's going to say it one more time on November 10th. He's asking for it, really.
If he really wanted, if his endorsement meant something, and somebody asked me, well, what does it mean? Did any of us ever see him out with Rosalind Nichols?
They were trying out to help together. And this raises the question, how important are any kind of endorsements?
Yes.
I mean, people make up their
Willie,
own mind. They don't like being
as
told.
As Bill was saying, Willie had the same problem. Willie Harrington tried to endorse people.
Harold Ford Sr. was the only person ever to make this kind of thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's again, I think it's a function of what the mayor does and the fact that the mayor's office is in this particular role. Mm-hmm. Willie Harrington tried it and very quickly said, he acknowledges, I learned I'm not Harold Ford Sr.
Well, the repercussions from this we'll be talking about for months to come. So let's move on to our next topic. Former Mayor Willie Harrington submitted applications to run some charter schools in the city. Bill, what does, do you know what Dr. Harrington plans to do with these charter schools?
He wants to run several charter schools in what remain now the separate city and the separate county school systems, even though you have one school board at this particular point. He's not going to bring them all online at once. There would be some federal subsidies that would be involved in running them. And he wants to run schools that are basically a function of his view of back to basics public education. Mm-hmm. So that's where he's going with it. He's talking about maybe opening two, I think, in the 2012, 2013 school year. And he's made his applications to the state along with a lot of other people in a state where there now is no cap on the number of charter schools that the state can approve.
Is there going to be any kind of financial disclosure associated with this plan that he has? I mean, who's backing him on this? Do we know? Do we have any idea?
Not at this point. The applications for a charter school are pretty extensive. It's over a dozen pages. There's a lot of financial detail about it. And so we're not sure of all of the details at this point. The state has a decision to make, obviously, on this and a lot of other applications.
Mm-hmm. The Unified Board has, from what I understand, about 60 days to approve or reject this. And we were talking earlier about the fact that even Willie Harrington will say that he's somewhat of a lightning rod, and considering the makeup of the Unified Board is, do you think that he's going to have any problems?
I think that anybody who proposes to run a charter school is a lightning rod to some extent, in that there's not a large margin for error, there's not a large margin of error for missteps that you make, and that's because much of the educational establishment, the separate city and county school board members, always took the attitude that even though charter schools were legally part of their public school systems, that they were a drain on resources for what they considered to be the real schools that they governed. And that outlook at the outset of this new countywide school board has really not changed to any appreciable degree. I was at a public hearing that Chris Barbic, who heads the state's Achievement School District, had this past week at Northside High School. One of the options for Northside, since it's one of the 5% lowest performing in the state, is that Northside could become a charter school run directly by the state. There are other options, but all the teachers in that meeting heard was that it could possibly be a charter school.
All right. Well, we're going to move on to our next topic, which is Herman Cain, who's starting to surprise the pundits by winning Republican straw polls. And Les, you did an interesting story this week about Herman Cain.
About Herman Cain, you know,
from Memphis.
From Memphis, and everybody right. said yes, Herman Cain. It's always in the small print, from native of Memphis, whatever, whatever. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to do some investigating into this guy because he has within 3 days, 8 days, he won three different straw polls in various states. This is a guy who pulled himself up, you know, with his own bootstraps. His great idol was his father, who was a very uneducated man who had been on an Arlington farm, moved to Memphis, met Cain's mother, who was a maid. His father worked three jobs, put two kids through college, including Herman. And so he learned from his father that color was never going to be a barrier. It's the kind of Horatio Alger story mm-hmm. that is really interesting. And that this guy he's going to tell it like it is. He's outspoken. And as we sit here a week from today, he will come to Bartlett on what will be the first of a three-city stopover in Tennessee. Here first, then on to Jackson, then on to Waverly. And we will get to see in person a Tennessee native son. And can what he's doing on a national level, which appears to be working, can he win over the reddest of red states? It'll be interesting to see what kind of reception he gets. Yeah.
And you know, the conventional wisdom is that a black candidate on the Republican ticket cannot win. On the other hand, how many advantages does President Obama still have in this terrible economy with the Democratic Party in a shambles most places? And you get a black and a Republican there, he will probably satisfy the GOP base. Mm-hmm. And he's going to carve into that black base of the Democrats a little bit. 3-5%, that's enormous in a presidential election.
Well, they were talking about, we're talking to Charlotte Bergman, who, of course, is a local candidate here. She's now becoming a perennial candidate against Steve Cohen for that 9th District congressional race, which is like next year or whatever, but she's still out there running. And she was talking about she has met Herman before and talked with him, and she says that he thinks he can get a third of the black vote in this country. And which I thought, wow.
He won't
but
do that well.
I don't know, he's not going to do that well. But he is that confident. He is building up more confidence.
Yeah.
And I think that if you see, the thing that he does is, compared to Romney, compared to Rick Perry, this guy is a straight talker. They're more of the technical, okay, and I'm going to, okay, now I'm going to say this, okay, all right. But Herman Cain shoots from the hip. People like shooters from the hip. Now, whether they want to elect him as president, that's a different story.
And will that remain the case if he continues to be more successful? Because
yes.
invariably the campaign consultants, if he continues to grow in his popularity, we'll get a hold of him, and we've all seen examples of what happens when the consultants convince you you have a lot to lose by being yourself.
Mm-hmm. Well, the real race is between Romney and whoever can contend against him, and Herman Cain probably can't beat Romney, but he can keep all the other non-Romneys out of it.
Well, okay. And I'll go even further and say that Romney will probably be the choice of the Tennessee Republican establishment mm-hmm. if he's not already.
Okay, well, we're going to move on to the sidebar, and one of the first stories in the sidebar is what is going on with the Greyhound bus terminal downtown? It's in a prime location, and apparently it's moving on, from what I understand, Bill.
It's now been listed by CBRE for $2.3 million. This is a key parcel. Greyhound is moving to the MATA facility, which is almost complete by the Memphis International Airport. This is a huge shift in terms of mass transportation, the part of it the Greyhound has a piece of. And this is a key piece of property between AutoZone Park and the Beale Street Entertainment District, a kind of no man's land that for decades city leaders and downtown boosters have wanted to link up.
Jackson, let's move on to you and talk about the fact that there has been a national movement that sprouted up, the Occupy Wall Street, which has come to Memphis.
There's a group called Occupy Memphis, mm-hmm. and they've actually had some impressive meetings with 100 or so people gathered in Overton Park to make plans. Unfortunately for them, so far they've only made plans, and when they've actually settled on time for action, they've only come up with a handful of that 100 people. Mm-hmm. They haven't occupied anything yet, either.
Oh, my gosh. Now, how many people did you actually see out there?
In Overton Park, a couple of nights ago, there were 100 people. The ones who showed, they made plans to show up in Court Square the next day. The next day, there were 20 or so people in Court Square, so there's not much follow-through.
Don't they have splintered interests? I mean, it's
yeah, you got Ron Paul people on the one side, yeah. You got the Peace and Justice
Center
on the
other. Yeah, and then the union people have started joining
They don't have a cohesion. They're leaderless by philosophy, and that hurts them, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, Amos, tell us about the progress involving the Ramsey statue. What's been going on with that?
There's no progress.
There is no progress.
University of Memphis was the only one to respond to an RFP to take the statue. Joe Brown, a city councilman, put a stop to that. He says, you know, he'd like to see it at the zoo or somewhere else where more people would see it. The only problem with that is the Memphis Zoo didn't respond to the RFP. Which was a very public process, you know, it was a public process. Do you want this statue? Only one organization, the University of Memphis, responded and said they wanted the statue. Hmm. But Joe Brown thinks it should be somewhere more public, and that's where we are right now. It's stalled.
I thought it was hilarious.
We don't know where it's going to go.
They brought in Dick Hackett, and they brought in
Glenn Campbell.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so what was the agreement with Hosni Mubarak and the government of Egypt?
And in Joe's defense, they were very clear that the contract said that the city could not sell the statue, that the city could lease it, but it cannot sell it.
Okay, well, quickly, I want to just ask you about NBA lockout. What do you think is going to happen with that? We have about 15 seconds.
It's serious. All the preseason is gone. A lot of the NBA stars are making their own deals now and looking to themselves. Play yourself into shape in the NBA. Are people going to pay for that? I don't think so.
Okay, well, that's all the time we have. Thanks for joining us.